All right. Thanks everybody for showing up. My name is Carsten Kozak. I'm a lawyer. I work for the American law firm Greenberg Traurig here in Berlin for the technology department and do quite a lot of work on data protection. This is particular, I guess that's why you are here. I guess all of you heard that a new data protection law has entered into effect effectively about 10 days ago. The new German, the new European General Data Protection Regulation, the GDPR, and actually imposed quite a lot of new obligations on all of you. So everybody who has a company, every company that is processing personal data will be affected by it. And for the next 45 minutes, I'm going to talk a little bit about. What that actually means, what is General Data Protection Regulation, what sort of main obligations are imposed on you, do you need to comply with those obligations when you are located in Germany, maybe your company is located somewhere in Europe, maybe outside of Europe, and what do you have to do and what sanctions might be imposed on you when you infringe the General Data Protection Regulation. So this is the workshop stage here. That basically means I'm going to talk for the next 40 minutes, but if you have any questions in between, please feel free to raise your arm or stand up or just say that question, and I'm happy to answer it. Okay, let's get started. So this is one of the silly jokes you might have heard about General Data Protection Regulation. Do you know a good lawyer? Yes. Can you give me his or her email address? No. It's rather stupid, but it actually describes the essence, to some extent, the essence of what GDPR is about. And we're going to come back to this in a minute, but there are basically two important aspects of it. We're going to talk about a lawyer. And then you might think, well, a lawyer's contact data, a lawyer's email address, why should that concern any regulation about personal data? And the answer is, it does. I mean, just because I'm a lawyer and just because I'm doing business does not mean that my work email address is not part of General Data Protection Regulation. So this is something, we're going to come back to it in a minute, but this is some really interesting aspect of GDPR. Yeah. No. Even the fact that it's freely available does not make any change to that regard. And then next aspect is, can you give me his or her email address? Yeah. And that raises to the question whether can we actually transfer any data? Okay, let's come back to it in a minute. Since we're talking about law, I'm sorry, but I have to talk at least about one minute about legal stuff. I'm going to talk a little bit about the background. What actually happened in the last 20 years? So you might have heard of it. We had a directive, a European directive on data protection from 95, actually means 1995. So the European data protection law until May 25th, so until 10 days ago, the European data protection law was based on a law from the year 1995. So if you think about it, I mean, how many electronic communication has happened back then in 1995? I guess not really. I mean, I think internet already existed, but has not really been used for business purposes. There was no data aggregation and all the stuff we are doing nowadays. So that was basically the reason why the European regulators in Brussels thought we need to do something new. We need to exchange and replace the existing law from 1995 by a new General Data Protection Regulation. There was also some e-privacy directive from the year 2002, but basically everything had been based on the directive from 1995. Now, the General Data Protection Regulation was adopted by the Brussels regulators in the year 2016. And is applicable since 25th of May 2018. And that's basically the reason why you might have received tons of emails about companies asking you to consent, that they may send you that they may continue sending you emails in the future, et cetera, et cetera. Hello? Okay. So who needs to comply? Then, you know, like a minute ago, I talked a little bit about, does GDPR apply to you when your company is established in Germany, when your company is established in Europe, or when your company is established outside of Europe? And that is actually quite crucial, because if in the past, when your company was established outside of the European Union, you basically were not required to comply with European data protection law, and that has changed. So nowadays we have the following situation. If your company is established within the European Union or the EEA, does anybody know what EEA means? Yeah. Exactly, European Economic Area, which is basically European Union plus Norway, Iceland, and yeah, Liechtenstein, correct. Okay, so if your company is established within that area, within the territory, you're automatically subject to general data protection regulation whenever processing any personal data. And it doesn't really have any effect whether that personal data relates to an individual who lives in Germany, in Europe, or in China. Any type of personal data that is processed by a company within the European Economic Area is subject to general data protection regulation. And that is massive. Basically, any company that's doing business in Europe is subject to general data protection regulation. But now, I mean, even if your company is established in China, in India, in the United States, you can also become subject to general data protection regulation and the sanctioning regime under two situations. That means first, let's say your company is established in the US, but you're offering goods and services via the website to European individuals. That makes it subject to GDPR. Or if your company is located in the US, you have a website and you're monitoring the website behavior of your users in order to provide them with advertisement, with targeted advertisement, for example, you're also subject to GDPR. So it doesn't really help to have a company outside of Europe. You still might become subject or be subject to general data protection regulation. And why is that so important? Basically because this here, yeah, sanctions. Does anybody of you know what the maximum sanctioning fine for data protection
in Germany was? Das sind die,
also ich mache das jetzt gerade.
Ah, okay, nobody.
Nein, aber wie viel haben wir auf dem Lager von den
Okay. I think that is
an Box. Für
anyhow, okay. And until 10 days ago, the maximum fine that a company could actually
wie viel sind
receive was 300,000 euros. There's a maximum fine. Now, if you know, the two ladies who just spoke from Google. Talk like in that situation. So at 20 million. So that's what we're talking about now. 300,000 2 weeks ago, and as of now, 20 million euros. Or if you belong to the Googles and Facebooks of this world, 4% of your total worldwide annual turnover, which might be significantly more than 20 million euros. That's a maximum fine that European data protection authorities might impose if you do not comply with GDPR. So that is actually something thinking about, and that's the reason why many, many companies now want to get GDPR compliant, because the sanctions are just so tremendous. And we're going to see how that actually turns out in practice. There has, as up to my knowledge, there has been no sanctions yet within the last 10 days, but let's see how that develops within the next couple of months. I'm sure that we're going to see some really significant fines being outspoken by the European Data Protection Authorities, yes?
I understand for Google and Facebook of the world, these kind of scary sanctions are quite valid, but what if there is a startup with 2-3 co-founders that cannot, that do their best to comply with GDPR, but had a problem and will get a sanction?
Yeah.
Will it still be 20 million
Yeah, very good question. Yeah. So, this is the possible sanctions. So, two answers to your question. First, this is only what the authorities can go up to. So, in practice, they need to do their discretion and say, okay, that's a startup. I mean, 10,000 euros already will hurt really much, so they can impose and say, okay, we only impose 10,000 euros. So that's up to the authorities. And the second part of the question of the answer is, it basically depends where you're located, because the authorities which are responsible for you depend in each country of Europe, and depend in Germany on the particular land or state in Germany where you're located. So if your company is located in Hamburg or in Kiel, then you're screwed, because those authorities are horrible. Sorry, I hope nobody from that authority is here. They're not horrible. They're just really, they're really enforcing. Yeah. But if you come from Bavaria or from, I don't know, from Hessen, even Berlin are reasonable. Then you can talk to them and say, we do our best, and you can actually, you know, interconnect with them. Well, the consumer can they can choose where they lock a complaint, but the responsible authority will be that authority where the company is located. So if you as a consumer lock a complaint, let's say here in Berlin, but the company against you which are complaining are located in Munich, the entire case will be deferred and transferred to Munich. So the Bavarian authorities will then take over. Correct. But in this case, if the authorities are outside of the European Economic Area or the company, then it will be one authority within the European Economic Area who does the sanctioning regime, the audit procedure, etc. But they actually are need help. They need help from someone from Switzerland. That's correct. That is correct. So, you know, next 1 minute, maybe just talking a little bit about the basic words and the basic expressions when we're talking about. You heard about probably processing, and there's a controller, and there's a processor, and there's if you read the news yesterday, you might have heard something about joint controllership with Facebook and Facebook fan pages. So, what's it actually all about? GDPR regulates the processing of personal data, and processing means basically everything you do with data. You copy the you use the data, you transfer the data, you collect the data, you make it available. This is basically everything you do with personal data is subject to GDPR. And the scope of your obligations is dependent on whether you are a controller or a processor. And that basically means if your company decides what to do with that data, then you're a controller, and you're subject to the full amount of all obligations under GDPR. But if you are a processor, it means if you are acting on behalf of another company, on behalf of the controller, for example, if you're doing cloud services, you're providing cloud services, that means you are storing and making available data for another company, then you're acting on behalf of that other company. In this case, you will only be a processor and only be subject to a limited amount of requirements under GDPR. And you know, as I said, if your company has a fan page, a Facebook fan page, and if you read the news yesterday, there was a court decision, or the decision by the European Court of Justice, who basically said that any company who has a fan page on Facebook is a joint controller together with Facebook. So that means any company, all of you who have a Facebook fan page, are responsible to comply with all obligations under GDPR, and not only with the limited obligations as a processor. And what does it actually mean? We don't know. The court has been deferred back to the Federal Administrative Court in Germany, and they're going to decide now what that actually means. But what yesterday happened was really traumatic, because anybody who has a fan page now needs to make sure that they're basically subject to sanctions, to whatever might happen when you infringe GDPR.
Instagram
Probably yes. I say probably because it has not been cited by the court. But if the structure is the same, what you need to ask yourself is, does the company has any discretion on deciding what happens with the data that has been collected by using that software? In Facebook, the court, with regard to the fan pages, the court said, well, any company can sort of structure the way which type of data are being collected and used by, you know, making different arrangements on the website. So that was how they concluded that you are a controller. And Instagram, let's see how that turns out. Okay, and the other thing, we said GDPR relates and regulates the processing of personal data. Next question, what is personal data? And if you, if you remember that stupid joke about the lawyer, it actually, that turns down or boils down to this one. Personal data is any information relating to an identified or identifiable natural person. A natural person is an individual. So what you can exclude from GDPR regulation is any type of data that only relates to company. So you have a GmbH, you have a limited, if you have a SAR, whatever type of company, any information that relates to that company, only to that company, is not subject to GDPR. So forget about it. It's not regulated at all. You can do with that data whatever you want. Any also means any type of aggregated data. So if you say your product is being used by, I don't know, last month had been used by 50 males at the age or in the age between 20 and 25, that is not subject to GDPR because it's not personal data. Why? Because it cannot be related to one particular individual. It's just as an information about a group of persons, but nothing about a particular identified or identifiable individual. Correct. And that's exactly what I mentioned at the beginning of this session. Any business contact information about a particular business contact is also personal data. Yeah. It normally you would think, well, you know, we're talking about individuals, we're talking about consumers, but that's not true. Any personal, any email address, work email address, work telephone number, of a person that also falls under personal data. You can, on the other hand, you can say, well, you know, when we talk about enforcement of GDPR obligations, it's rather likely that the authorities will not really have a focus on business contact information. It's more likely that they will have a focus on consumers and, you know, individuals using that, whose data is being used in the context of, you know, their own private household purposes. Yeah, easy answer, no. Because if it's aggregated data, then it's not personal data, and then it's not subject to GDPR.
But isn't it, I read an article, and there were 100 articles about this topic, but it said if it's market research, it's still GDPR.
Yeah, if it can be identified or can be related to individuals. Maybe we talk offline after the session. But okay, and yeah, this is just examples, different type of personal data. There's also this, you know, sensitive data. When you're engaged in the health business, for example, you know, do hospital software, whatever, tech in hospitals and stuff like that. You're processing health data, or you're processing data regarding religious beliefs or sexual tendencies and orientations. That is all regarded as sensitive data, and that means that higher and stricter rules apply. I think that's it for now, but you just need to distinguish between normal data and sensitive data when you think about what your company does and what type of data your company is processing. Now, if you leave in about, I don't know, 25 minutes or earlier, one thing please remember, because that's the essence of European data protection law, and that's like the most important thing you need to remember. The second most important. The first important thing is GDPR only personal data. And the second important thing is the so-called lawfulness of processing. So that's really important. And let's make a comparison to the United States. In the US, the principle is you can do whatever you want with personal data unless it's prohibited. Yeah? It's always allowed unless it's prohibited. And in Europe, it's just the other way around. So processing of personal data is always prohibited. You may not process personal data unless that individual to who the data pertains has consented, or there is a law which allows you to process the data for that particular purpose. And unfortunately, I'm sorry, that's law. Yeah, it's a bit boring, but that's really important to understand. I mean, whatever you do with personal data in your company, you have to think, do I have the consent, or do I need the consent? Or does GDPR says, well, you're actually allowed to process the data? And we do not need to go through all of this legal statutory provisions which allow you to process personal data, but let's maybe talk about those two because they're really important. One is processing is necessary for the performance of a contract with that data subject, with the individual. And that basically means whenever you enter into a contract with a consumer, you may use the consumer's data in order to fulfill the contract. If you're an online merchant and you say goods via the internet, then you need to collect the name, the shipping address, and maybe the email address and the payment information of that consumer to who you sell goods. But you do not need to have the consent in order. You don't need to ask for the consent of that individual in order to process that data. You may do so because it's necessary in order to perform and execute the contract. It would be a little bit awkward if you would need to ask them, you know, can I use your shipping address in order to send you the goods you just ordered? Of course, so you may do so. And the other important thing is compliance with legal obligations. Then you do not need to ask for consent. And then there's something like legitimate interest. Anybody who has, like, you know, read a little bit about GDPR knows that this, you know, if my interest is higher than the interest of the individual, I might actually do that, what I want to do. That's the essence of it. And what does it really mean? I have no idea, and nobody knows. And let's see how the authorities construe and interpret that section. So we need to wait for the next couple of months, how that actually works out. Huh. Maybe one sentence about consent. If you ask for consent, it must be freely specific, ambiguous. It must be, in some situations, explicit when you're processing sensitive data. But basically, I mean, what is important to know is that consent must be given. It must be documented. It must be clearly given by that particular individual. That individual must know that you consent. If you hide it somewhere in your terms and conditions, I hereby consent, in the fine print at the end, that will not work. If you highlight it and make it clear, so the individual actually knows when consenting you to your terms and conditions that they consent to the processing of data, then that will likely be sufficient. Now, that might be of interest to you, marketing emails. You probably received this really onerous emails from so many companies where they say you're on our marketing list, and because of GDPR, we need to ask you whether you want to stay in our list. Well, you know, in a nutshell, that is all of no substance, because there was really no right and no obligation under GDPR to ask or to re-ask for marketing email consent. But let's clarify that a little bit. The problem is that GDPR says, general, if you want to send marketing emails to consumers or business contacts, you need their consent. But GDPR says you might also rely on legitimate interest, but it doesn't really go into detail and say under which circumstances that might be the case. The recitals of GDPR say something like, it is okay to use marketing emails without consent on basis of legitimate interest, but it doesn't really go into detail when that's the case and when not. The German authorities have been not really helpful in identifying and clarifying when this is the case. The ICO, the European Information Commission Officer, they actually released something really helpful, a piece of paper where they said, well, it's okay if it's proportionate, if the marketing email has a minimum privacy impact, and if the addressee is not surprised or likely to object to receiving marketing emails. Well, you know, what does it mean? I don't really know. But so again, let's see how that turns out. But basically, what you can see, if you have existing relationship with consumers or individuals, it is likely that you can send them marketing emails without consent. If you want to do any cold call, any cold emails, you know, to individuals who have had no prior contact, then it's rather likely that it's not okay, that you do actually need the consent. So that is like what we can say nowadays. And anything in between, you know, like former business contacts, et cetera, is that okay? Do you need to have the consent? Well, let's see how that turns out. To be on the secure side, I would always recommend to actually obtaining consent. It's probably the best way.
This is different, for example, for user tracking. Mm-hmm. If you had consent to a privacy policy that declared user tracking, but it was less detailed, and you don't have, you know, a clear proof of consent in every case, then the user tracking, you need to get new consent.
Yep. So you need to inform the users about what to actually do with that data. So, you know, that consent requirement also referred to a so-called informed consent. So consent only works if the user actually knows what he or she is consenting to. So you need to inform them. Yeah, that is correct. And the entire marketing email structure is a little bit complicated by the fact that it's not only subject to GDPR, but there's also another law in Europe, the so-called e-privacy directive, which includes some sort of anti-spam rules, and which say if you want to do email marketing against to consumers, you always need the prior consent, and there are some certain exemptions relating to situations where you market goods or services that the consumer has already purchased in the past, then you might not be able or not be required to ask for consent. But in general, the e-privacy directive says you need to do it. No, so it gets a little bit complicated. You have GDPR, you have the e-privacy directive. If you look at it from a sanctioning perspective, GDPR 20 million, e-privacy directive, no sanctions. At least not in directive. So each EU member state can actually impose their own sanctions. Okay, marketing emails. And now, sharing personal data with vendors. This is something you probably already have had some contact with. Whenever you are sharing data, personal data, with vendors, that means with a companies that are processing that personal data on your behalf, for example, cloud service providers, payroll providers, you know, any type of company that you use in order to provide services for you on the basis where they process your personal data, so the personal data that you hold in your company. And whenever you do that, when you ever engage with those type of vendors and processors, GDPR says that you need to enter into a contract, a so-called data processing agreement, which includes certain mandatory clauses, mandatory terms. And the difference to what we had in the past was that now, both basically, your company and the vendor, the processor, will be liable if that does not happen. So you should have received from all of your vendors within the last couple of weeks before GDPR entered into effect a draft data processing agreement, if that hasn't already been concluded in the past, which include the mandatory clauses and the GDPR. And those mandatory clauses say, you know, when and under which situations are you allowed to use sub-processors, the DPA, the Data Processing Agreement, must impose certain data security obligations on the vendor. And it needs to be clear that the data may only be processed as instructed by the controller, like means by your company in that particular situation. So if you want to check whether you are GDPR compliant, check whether you have DPAs with all of your vendors. If not, then you need to get active. Please. Mm-hmm. That's okay. Yeah. Yeah. So that consent that you just referred to, that is one point of GDPR obligations, but it does not replace that obligation. But you do not need to enter into a DPA with the landlord, because the landlord will process that information on their own behalf. They are not processing data on behalf of your company. They need their data in order to have that tenant come to their apartment. So they only use it for their own purposes. But the property manager, that's a different thing. They are acting on your behalf. So you actually do need to have a DPA, a data processing agreement with the property manager. Yeah, please.
Is it true that you only have to show intent and send out the DPAs?
No. Yeah. Well, it's good if you can show that you did that. Against the or vis-a-vis the data protection authorities, but you would still infringe GDPR if the contract is not signed. Should get active, resend them again. If they insist not to sign it, then the ultimate thing would be not to stop business relationship with them. But that's of course something you need to decide on a business level. Yeah, please. Sorry, I couldn't hear.
What about if you process the data, the personal data within the company, like consultant,
yeah,
and you don't process it on the company systems, but on your own company systems, but on the company system that the data belongs to? Do you still need a DPA?
It depends what you mean under company system that which belongs to. Is that another entity? If it's another legal entity. Ah, okay. And on behalf and for that company you're working for, I guess. Yeah. So you
don't have an influence on that system, right? You just do see the data.
Yeah, that's enough. I mean, seeing the data, having access to the data, making the data available or have that data available, that's sufficient in order to the requirement that you need to have a DPA. Yeah, I know. Yeah, I mean, you need to go to a good lawyer and have that being reviewed. But I know. Yeah. I mean, that's a general point. There are so many jokes about GDPR, and this is another one. It's just like the law says you need to have that agreement, and they don't really think about, well, it might fit to 95% of all business relationship and models, but there are 5 to 10% where it doesn't fit. And then what do you do? I don't know. Go to your lawyer and ask them. I mean, it's really difficult. Understand? Yeah. Please. What? Yeah, okay. Yeah, absolutely. And I'm a little bit surprised because all of the big service companies in the US, they're already GDPR compliant, and they have been sending out, like within the last weeks and months, DPAs to all of the customers. So like all the big ones, like Salesforce, you know, all the really big companies, they're aware of it, and I'm surprised. If they don't accept it, they will run out of business, at least with the European customers, I'm sure. Was there another question, or should we? Yeah.
Nobody knows exactly what the rules will look like. So if you're a small little startup,
yeah.
Doing some stuff, what's the likelihood that anything will happen? Let's wait and see until all the stuff has been more specific and everybody knows what's happening.
Yeah. I don't really know what to say to that. I can tell you the following. Let's turn the question. Ask you when is it likely that the authorities will knock on your door and do an audit? And they're basically, at least from the past, what I've seen under the old law, and this is not going to change under the new law. There are basically two situations where you might get a visit from the authorities. The first situation is that the authorities they have a focus on certain industry and say, okay, for the next 3 months we're going to look at that industry, like internet web shops from the US or whatever. And then if you fall under the category, you receive a letter and they ask you what you're actually doing. Please tell us, and then the audit starts. And the other situation, and which is actually even that happens more often in practice, is if you have somebody, some individual, which feels that you are acting against them and, you know, disadvantaging them or whatever, you know, I don't know, they're angry against you. Then what they do, they go to the data protection authorities and tell them, you know, my data was misappropriated and they need to do something. So the data protection authorities, if a complaint is filed, then they need to become active and they need to go to you and ask you what you're actually doing with the customer. And then you tell them, well, we did this with the customer, and they say, well, that's not really okay. And what other things do you do? And then things go up and up and up. I had that in the past, a couple of years ago, a huge audit by the Berlin Data Protection Authorities against a US company, and it started with one of these questions from an individual, and it turned out about that the entire thing ran for 2 years. And like the entire structure, data processing structure, was under review. You know, how do you pool like HR data in the US and transfer Europe, and that was horrible. But yeah, that's the answer I can give you. Try to avoid to have individuals that are angry against you, if that's somehow possible. Okay, I think we have only 5 minutes, so let's see what is really interesting. I think this might be of interest to anyone of you who either is located outside of Europe or who does business with companies outside of Europe. There is one thing you need to understand is you have one data protection regime in Europe, and any transferring of data within Europe, and that means within the European Economic Area, is subject to this legality requirement that means you need to have the consent, or you need the law tell you may actually transfer the data. But then on top of it, if you transfer the data out of the European Economic Area, then additional requirements apply. And that basically means you may only transfer the data to a company in the US, in India, in China, in New Zealand, whatever, if it can be ensured that the data is safely and adequately secured and stored and processed in that location. And there are different types of possibilities how you can actually ensure that. We don't have to go through all these details, but this might be interesting. The adequacy decision, the European Commission actually said that some countries like Canada, Israel, Switzerland, they have a type of data standard that is comparable to what we do have in Europe, so you don't have to care about it. That basically means it's the same if you transfer it within or outside of Europe to those countries. And you might have heard of the Privacy Shield, that is a system where US company can register with the Department of Commerce in the US and self-certify that they basically adhere to the basic standards of European data protection law. And if they do so, you might also transfer data to them. So, like anything that relates to international data transfers outside of Europe, that would be subject to those additional requirements. Okay, we have 3 minutes left. Let's see. Privacy policy. well, all of you have a privacy policy. I mean, all of the companies you do have to have a privacy policy. And if you haven't updated your privacy policy to make it GDPR compliant, that's the first thing that you should do. Why? Because, first of all, GDPR says that new additional information need to be provided and given under the in the privacy policy. And second, if you look from the sanctioning angle, that is basically the first thing that anybody can take a look at you when they want to know whether you are GDPR compliant or not. Why? Because the privacy policy is somewhere available, mostly on the website. So if you have entered into a DPA or not, yeah, that might infringe GDPR, but it's not really that somebody from outside can easily find out about. Yeah, the authorities need to ask you, do you have a DPA, and then you need to answer, and in the meantime, you already entered into a DPA. But privacy policy, that is available on your website. So if your privacy policy does not include all of the mandatory information, anybody, any competitor can take a look at it and say, well, you're infringing GDPR and you need to do something and you're violating and sanctions and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. So this is something I would recommend like as a first step to get that done. Okay. And those are the list of various information that you need to have included in your privacy policy. And the last 1 minute, I'm going to talk about data subject rights. Data subject rights means that now, and this is something new, really important, any individual has a right against you as a company to ask you those particular rights. The most important right nowadays that has already been happened in practice is a right to access, right of access and info. That basically means any individual can send you a letter or an email and say, please inform me, A, whether or not you're processing personal data of myself. Do you have any personal data about me? And then you need to answer within 1 month. Or they can ask you, okay, you do have data about me. Please give me a copy of all of the personal data you hold on file. And imagine if you have 10,000 individuals, 10,000 consumers with which you're doing business, each single consumer can write you an email and say, please inform me what type of data you're processing. What does that mean? It basically means you have to answer those questions. And for you, that means you have to implement internal policies to make sure that you can actually deal with all those questions. Because if you receive 100 emails a day and you are not prepared, you will not be able to follow that request, at least not within 1 month. And then you might run into trouble because you're violating GDPR. And I think that's basically it. It's 1 a.m. No, it's 1 p.m. Thank you very much for your time. I have one more thing I want to show you, which is really something nice. Not this one. It's not nice. I hate that picture. Come on, here. So. We are having drinks tonight, so if you have time, you're invited to come between 7:30 and 10 p.m. to a rooftop terrace. No, it's actually on top of the rooftop terrace at the Panorama Punkt. It's at Potsdamer Platz, where our office is located. And we're going to have drinks, and all of us who are here in the audience will be there and happy to chat with you and talk to you about data protection or anything else of interest. Thank you very much.